Today. And even though our time in lockdown has been extended by a further 3 weeks, let me encourage you with the words that we find in Joshua 1 verse 9. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go and no matter what life brings. I do trust that you will truly know his blessing in this time together.
August the 5th, disaster in the desert. 33 miners trapped 700 metres underground.
There it is! Don Lucho, the last miner.
A teenage surfer spotted a drowning boater and then paddled out to save his life.
There's this guy, and he was like coming around the inlet, so I paddled to the end of the inlet and like where the current is, and I gave him my surfboard.
An immigrant from Mali. Being called a real-life Spider-Man after he rescued a child dangling from a balcony.
Our reading is taken from Luke's Gospel, chapter 23, and verses 50 to 56. Now there was a man named Joseph, a member of the council, a good and upright man, who had not consented to their decision and action. He came from the Judean town of Arimathea, and he was waiting for the kingdom of God. Going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus' body. Then he took it down, wrapped it in linen cloth and placed it in a tomb cut in the rock, one in which no one had yet been led. It was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. The women who had come with Jesus from Galilee followed Joseph and saw the tomb and how his body was laid in it. Then they went home and prepared spices and perfumes, but they rested on the Sabbath in obedience to the commandment. Amen.
Good morning, boys and girls. I hope you've had a great week. Hasn't the weather been amazing? I hope you've been joining in with all the online Sunday school and other activities for young people this past month. Well, just to remind us, let's hear from Andrew. Make sure you get involved. No one should feel alone just because we're not able to meet together. See you all soon. Bye bye.
Good morning, church family. It is great to be able to connect with you through the internet as part of our service this morning. I just wanted to take some time to update you on what we've been doing for our children and young people. So there's been a couple of things that we have done, and we hope that your family have connected in with that. If you've got young people in your family and they haven't connected in, then please do encourage them to do so. If your family is slightly older or maybe you don't have children of your own, then please do continue to pray for us. We would really value that at the moment. So for our younger children in Sunday school, we have launched Sunday school online. And this morning saw week four of that, and we're looking at prayer. And that happens at the same time as the morning service over on our youth Facebook channel. And on a Saturday night, we are releasing resources to parents and guardians to print off for the children to take part in on the Sunday morning. And then on Sunday, at the same time as the main service goes out to all you guys, a video goes out to our children as well for them to take part in. It's not a very long service, it's only about 10 to 15 minutes. But it just keeps them connected with us, it keeps their learning, and it keeps them growing in their relationship with God. For our teenagers and our youth, we've been trying to keep up with as many of our youth programs as possible. We've moved YF to a weekly program instead of a fortnightly one. And YF now meets every night on the online video conferencing platform Zoom. And for an hour, we just study the Bible together. We just chat about how the week has been going, and we encourage each other. And over the past few weeks, we've been looking at the subject of victory and hope and learning who God is in our lives and who God says we are. And it's through that that we hope to be able to continue to encourage our young people to pursue their relationship with Jesus. As well as that, we have completed some Bible studies together using the YouVersion app. We've had Youth Club online where we've played some games together and just chatted for a period of time on Saturday nights. And we've been running a young men's group as well to allow the young men to continue to link in and connect together on a fortnightly basis. As well as that, we've had some challenges that we've been releasing on our youth social pages. We've revived the classic TV game show Through the Keyhole, and every other week we've had pictures of different leaders' houses, and the young people have had to guess whose house they're in. We've also been doing Worship Wednesday, where we've been sending out a kids' worship song, and we've been encouraging children, young people and their families to get involved and to send us some videos of what they've been doing. Our other thing to try and support the government guidance around continually washing your hands is we've been challenging young people to show us how they wash theirs. We all know that the guidance is to sing Happy Birthday twice, to wash your hands for roughly around about 20 seconds. But we know in Ballygowan we can do better than that. So we've been encouraging people to send us their video of them washing their hands to their favourite worship song. And we've had a few of those in so far, and they've been up on our social pages. But here, as a special treat for you, here is this week's hand wash video, courtesy of the Cleveland family. We look forward to when we can be together again and get all our programmes back up and running. Our youth weekend had to be postponed. It was due to happen in March, and we've postponed that now, and it will now happen in the second week of September. We're very aware that for our P7s, this is a great time of transition, and it's going to be a wee bit more difficult this year, so we are working behind the scenes as well to see what we can do to support them and to help them transition into youth for September. We have lots of exciting stuff planned for the later part of the summer and into the autumn, and we pray and we hope that we can be back together with you again by then. If you have any questions about what we've been doing for young people, please do reach out. My mobile number and my email address are on the church website, or send me a message on Facebook. But I look forward to that time when we can meet together in church again. And until then, please do continue praying for young people. We will most definitely be continuing to pray for you. It is great to be able to meet together as a church family in this way. Be blessed, guys.
So let us unite our hearts in prayer. Let us pray together. God of wonder across this universe, we acknowledge that you are a holy God. We thank you that in your power and might you still determine to love us, not because of who we are, but rather because of who you are. You are an awesome God, a God of grace and a God of mercy. You are Lord of all the earth, and we call on you this day. In this time of global pandemic, our horizons are suddenly expanded. Hard borders in the island of Ireland, trade borders in the Irish Sea, building bridges to Scotland, they seem so much less important when politics is paralysed and retail is receded. All our insular red lines are increasingly fading to pink, and suddenly we are interested in what is happening in Italy and in Spain, and we are keen to learn from the experiences of other countries like China. Father, impress upon us in these days that we really are global disciples. We are part of a bigger church and a bigger world. We are called to love those from whom we are socially distanced, but we are also to pray with passion for those from whom we are spatially distanced and will never meet. Hear our prayer for nations near and far, for peoples of every tribe and tongue, for the global effort to fight this virus. Remind us that Jesus shall reign where'er the sun does his successive journeys run, his kingdom stretch from shore to shore, till suns shall rise and set no more. Father, we pray for every country and among all peoples touched by this pandemic. We particularly remember those in poorer countries with no health service. And we especially remember those closest to us in Chomoko and Budé. We pray for progress and global cooperation to achieve greater understanding of how to slow this pandemic, the sharing of medical supplies and protective equipment, as well as scientific research in finding a vaccine. Father, we give thanks for those who are working hard to support the NHS, and especially people like Captain Tom Moore, who in this his 100th year has set an amazing example to us all. May he and others who do so much truly know your blessing. Lord of all peoples, hear our prayers from this place for your world. In Jesus' name, amen.
One of the benefits of lockdown is being at home. So often my life has been spent, as I'm sure has been the same with many others, working, coming home, having some tea, and then out again in the evening to various meetings or activities. It was a rare night to be at home. Now it's even a rarer night to be out, except for a walk or to work in the garden. So during the past week in the evening, we have been watching Quiz, the story about the deception to win £1 million on the game show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. In one of the scenes after the show, when suspicions are raised, people gather in a room. They gather to re-watch the show, and time again, at certain points, the request is made, rewind the tape. There are points of interest that people wanted to see again. They wanted to be sure of, and so the command was given, rewind. Easter has passed, and it would be so easy to move on, but I want us to rewind, to go back to some of the scenes of that first Easter, because just like those in the quiz who missed important details, I think it is easy to miss important details about the first Easter. And I want us to do that as we look at one of the characters of Easter, Joseph of Arimathea. Joseph is so important in the Easter story that he's mentioned in all four of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. They all record what he does for the Lord Jesus. First of all, as we rewind, let us notice the context about what took place at the cross on that first Good Friday. The Sanhedrin, they wanted Jesus crucified. But they were also keen that the bodies on the three crosses wouldn't remain in position because they didn't want to defile the Passover Sabbath day. They didn't mind having Jesus killed. The one who had been declared innocent 7 times, that was okay. But to have the Passover, a religious festival, defiled, that wasn't acceptable. Do you see the irony, the hypocrisy of these religious people? The very thing that Jesus had warned them about. Matthew records the words of Jesus. In the same way, on the outside, you appear to be people as righteous, but on the inside, you're full of hypocrisy and wickedness. And of course, the New Testament reminds us and warns us, if we are believers in Jesus and followers of Jesus, therefore rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander of every kind. The normal length for a person to die by crucifixion perhaps took 2 to 3 days. So as the Sanhedrin wanted the bodies removed, they asked Pilate that the legs of those on the cross might be broken. That required the soldiers taking a mallet and breaking the legs of those on the cross. That resulted in a very quick death. John, in his Gospel, records in chapter 19, "But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water." The Roman soldiers are experts in death. That was their job. They were executioners. They knew dead people. So they break the legs of the 2 thieves. But when they come to Jesus, he was already dead. They pierce his side with a spear. And it is recorded that it brings a sudden flow of blood, another indication that Jesus was dead. Why, you might be asked, am I emphasizing this? Well, simply because one of the arguments against the resurrection of Jesus is this, that he wasn't really dead, that he swooned, that he went into semi-coma, and in the cool of the tomb, he revived and walked out. John records the death of Jesus. The soldiers knew he is dead. The centurion at the cross knew he was dead. When Joseph comes and asks Pilate for the body, he is surprised that Jesus is dead, so he sends another centurion who confirms the death of Jesus. So Pilate knows Jesus is dead. Those who took Jesus from the cross and wrapped him in linen cloth know he is dead. Jesus is physically dead. So here's the answer to those doubters, those skeptics who deny the death and the resurrection of Jesus. But there's something even more wonderful taking place here. John is an eyewitness to these events and he explains why they happened. In John chapter 19, these things happened so that the scriptures would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, they look on the one they have pierced. The legs of Jesus not being broken fulfilled the Old Testament concerning the Messiah, that not a bone of him shall be broken, we're told in the Psalms. During the ministry of John the Baptist, speaking about Jesus, he declares, "Behold, the Lamb of God, he takes away the sin of the world." And how appropriate. At the Passover season, when people remembered the deliverance by God from bondage in Egypt by the blood of the Lamb, pointing to the promised Lamb, the Messiah, the Lamb of God, the Lord Jesus, who would become the sacrifice for sin. And you see, the Passover Lamb was to be without blemish, and it cannot have a broken bone. So again, here Jesus fulfills the prophecy of yet another Old Testament prophet, Zechariah. They look at him, they have pierced. Jesus fulfills the scriptures. He is dead. Because if he is not dead, he cannot rise again. And why did John write these things? The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you may believe. How important to know. How important to believe that Christ died. How important to believe and to know that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures. Nothing other than the death of Jesus can pay for your sins and mine. As someone has written, his incarnation and sermons and parables and miracles and sinless obedience to law would have availed nothing if he had not died. Here is our hope. Upon a life I have not lived, upon a death I did not die, another's life, another's death, I stake my whole eternity. Can I ask you, do you believe? Are you a believer in Jesus who died for sin and for sinners? Who died for us? That's the context. But something else is really important, I think, that John records for us. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Jesus was in control of his own death. This wasn't a tragedy. During this past week, this was the week when we remembered the 108th anniversary of the sinking of the Titanic. That was a tragedy. And it's been remembered and continues to be remembered right around the world. But what happens here is not a tragedy, because we see that Jesus is in control of his own death. He gave up his spirit. Jesus had been on the cross for 6 hours. He gave up his life at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. The cross wasn't this tragedy. Jesus was in complete control. Death could not take him. He gave up his spirit. When Jesus died, he did so by his own power. He had finished the work that God had given him to do. There was no further work to do. It was complete. And it was at that determined and precise moment that he died. Yes, his death is real. And he gave up his spirit. And we're reminded the reason of his death. Mark tells us that the Son of Man did not come to serve, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. He gave his life as a ransom for many. He was in control of his death. In that lovely chapter of John, chapter 10, where Jesus is described as the good shepherd. "I am a good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. I lay down my life for the sheep. I lay my life only to take it again. No one takes it from me. I lay it down of my own accord." He died that we might be forgiven. He died to make us good, that we might go at last to heaven saved by his precious blood. He was in control of his own death. It wasn't a tragedy. He was in control of it. And surely the one who controls death and is in control of his own death, the one who gives his life as a ransom, is the one who's worthy to be trusted. Have you? And are you trusting in Jesus, who is in control of all things? And it is at this point then that we're introduced to the character of Joseph. Joseph is so important in the story of Jesus that he is mentioned, as we said, in all of the Gospels. And it's from all of those Gospels that we learn so much about this man. We learn that he was a religious man. He was a member of the Sanhedrin, Luke tells us in chapter 23. I like what one person said, that Joseph was appointed by God to be the guardian of Christ's body in the womb. Another Joseph was to be the guardian of his body in the tomb. Joseph was one of the 70 members who made up the council of the Sanhedrin. We're not sure whether he was a priest or a layperson, but he was a member of that Supreme Court who made the decision about the crucifixion of Jesus. But Luke reminds us that Joseph had not consented to their plan. He's a deeply religious man. He would have been preparing for the Passover. But once he became involved in the death and the burial of the Lord Jesus, he would have become defiled, unclean. So Joseph had a decision to make. Who or what was more important? Religion or Jesus? And it took only moments for Joseph to make that decision, to make that choice, and it was Jesus. The choice we all face. Religion or Jesus? Some people are so religious they don't have time for Jesus. It's about ritual religion, but not Jesus. Could it be that for someone listening to this today, that what is keeping you from Jesus is your religion, your tradition, your perceived goodness, your church attendance, your church membership, your communion taking? So when you hear the gospel and the need of trusting in what Jesus did through the cross for your salvation, the barrier, the defense, is your religion. For Joseph, there was no hope and no joy in religion and in Jesus Christ. He was a religious man. But we're also told that he was a rich man. Matthew tells us that it was placed in his own tomb that he had cut out of the rock. He was a rich man. To be the owner of a tomb near Jerusalem was an indication of wealth and status. Tombs could only be carved out of rocks and were very expensive. Only the rich could afford one. Joseph was a man, therefore, who had considered his own mortality and had made preparation. And we can and we should make such preparations. But much more important is, who have we trusted with our death? I remember speaking with a man on one occasion. He'd got bad news regarding his health. He'd made all kinds of arrangements. He told me he had made arrangements with the undertaker, his headstone, his grave plot, the hymns that he was put on his son. And then I asked him, but what about eternity? What happens after you die? Have you prepared for that? No, he said. But thankfully he did come to trust Christ with his death. Joseph was a rich man who loved Jesus. His riches wouldn't be a hindrance to him coming and following Jesus. He was willing to give up his status, his standing, to be identified with Jesus Christ. He was prepared to give everything to Jesus. He was prepared to give him his very best. And yet so often the very opposite is true. Didn't Jesus preach that? What would it profit a man if he would gain the whole world and lose his soul? And why is it important that Joseph was rich and that Jesus was buried in his tomb? Well, you see, those who were crucified, their bodies were dumped. And some think that the place called Golgotha got its name as the place of skull because so many skulls were visible in that dumping ground. But this wasn't to be for Jesus. Joseph would see to that. But there's something even more wonderful going on here, other than the care and the compassion of Joseph, the body of Jesus. Hundreds of years before, Isaiah spoke of how Jesus would be crucified. That lovely chapter, Isaiah 53, reminds us that he was punished by God, stricken and afflicted. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. All we like sheep have gone astray, we've turned each one his own way, and the Lord has laid in him the iniquity of us all. But as you go through that chapter, we come to verse 9, and this is what we're told. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death. Joseph, motivated by love, is actually again fulfilling the prophecy of Isaiah 53. Again, from scripture, the proof that Jesus is the Christ, the Savior sent from God. Yet you still don't believe and trust him. He was a rich man. But he was also a respectable man. Mark tells us that he was a respected member of the council. Luke tells us that he was a good and a righteous man. He was good, moral, upright, respected citizen, someone who was trustworthy, dependable, someone with integrity, someone who could be counted on. He was a respectable man. But much more importantly, the scriptures tell us that he was a righteous man. Now, this is the most important fact about Joseph. He was a righteous man. And the word righteous here is the same word as used to describe Jesus. Luke 23 and 47. Certainly this was a righteous man referring to Jesus. Jesus was righteous by nature. He was perfect. He was innocent. He was without sin. He was perfectly righteous. But how could that be said about Joseph? How could Joseph be righteous like Jesus? Well, let me go to Paul's letter to the Philippians. This is what he says. Not having my own righteousness which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ. The righteousness which is from God by faith. Paul was righteous not because of his religious background or his respectability or his duties, but because he trusted in Jesus. It's the same for Joseph. Matthew tells us that Joseph was a disciple of Jesus. He was righteous, not because of anything of himself, not because he was rich and respectable and religious. He was righteous because he was trusting in Jesus. And so too, we can only become righteous when we trust in Christ. It's a great exchange that took place at Calvary. It's what Easter is all about. Paul sums it up like this. He made him who knew no sin, Jesus, to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Jesus takes our sin and gives us his righteousness. We only become righteous, acceptable by God, when we trust in Jesus and what he's did for us at the cross. That's when the great exchange takes place. Joseph was regarded as righteous as Jesus, but his righteousness is a gift by grace. So too is ours. And when we resist, and when we don't trust Jesus, and when we say we're good enough, really what we're saying is that I'm as good as Jesus and I don't need the cross. The great hymns that we sing remind us, nothing in my hand I bring, simply the cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace, far thou to the fountain fly, wash me, Saviour, or I die. He took my sins and my sorrows, he made them his very own, he bore the burden of Calvary, he suffered and died alone. But Joseph was a cowardly man. He had many commendable qualities, but here's one that we would never want to copy. John tells us that, being a disciple, but secretly for fear of the Jews. He was a secret disciple because of fear of Jews. In other words, what would others think if he declared himself to be a follower, a believer in this Jesus who claimed to be the Messiah? It's a very real fear, isn't it? It's a very real fear for each one of us that we face, particularly these days, that when being a Christian, being openly a follower of Jesus, is mocked. Mocked by those around us, mocked in the media, scorned maybe by those that you work along with. If you don't make it known that you're Christian because, like Joseph, you are fearful of what others might think. Doesn't the Bible tell us that the fear of man brings a snare? Fear to make yourself known and me to make myself known as a believer in Jesus is a trap of the evil one. When he causes us to be silent, he causes the gospel to be silent because we're not speaking for Jesus. Our witness doesn't need to be brash and bold or brazen, but simple and quiet and honest by simply declaring, I believe in Jesus and all that he's done for me at the cross. Paul tells us if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God raised from the dead, we shall be saved. What blessings we miss when we don't speak up for Jesus. And as we see shortly what blessing Joseph received when he took his public stand for Jesus, the blessing of being the only one to ask the body of Jesus, the blessing of being recorded in all four of the Gospels. And what made the difference? What caused Joseph to stand up for Jesus? Surely it was the cross. The cross made the difference. And when we rightly understand the cross and all that Jesus did for us, sure, it's not too much for us not to be ashamed and to make it known that we are his followers. Is there someone that you and I need to tell that we're followers of Jesus? Do we need to be praying for this opportunity to speak and to stand up for Jesus? One final thing. We see Joseph's courage. Mark tells us, Joseph, a prominent member, he went and asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Here was a man who had been frightened, who had been fearful, now going to Pilate to ask for the body of Jesus. And the word that is used here meant that he went boldly, he went courageously. He goes courageously because he knows there will be a cause. More than likely now, he will be expelled from the Sanhedrin. He was openly identifying himself with the man who had been crucified. He is openly identifying himself with a criminal. But where did that courage come from? It comes again from the cross. When we feel fearful, when we need courage, we need to remember the words that we're not our own, that we've been bought with a price. We remember the words of Hebrews, looking unto Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Oh, to the courage of Joseph. And to know the experience of Joseph, of Jesus, that he was wounded for me, wounded for me. There on the cross he was wounded for me. Gone my transgressions. And now I'm free. All because Jesus was wounded for me. Is that true for you today? Are you thanking God for what Jesus did for you at the cross? Like Joseph, will you identify with Christ to become his disciple? Will you take up the cross and follow Jesus? For he invites us all to come to that place. For it's only at that place that we become acceptable to God. The great exchange. Give him your sin and receive his righteousness and be welcomed into his family. Amen. Fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore.